Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
On today's program, you will hear reports from John Russell and Mario Ritter, Jr. Bryan Lynn presents this week's technology report. We close the show by hearing today's lesson of the day from Jill Robbins and Andrew Smith. But first, this report.
The head brewmaster for Weihenstephan, the world's oldest brewery, has a secret. The secret is that he really likes to drink alcohol-free beer. Tobias Solo is quick to say that he enjoys real beer more. Still, the expert brewer says he enjoys alcohol-free beer when he is working. Alcohol-free beer has the same taste as usual beer, but has fewer calories, he said. The caloric reduction is a result of the brewery's process of evaporating the alcohol. You can't drink beer every day, unfortunately, he joked recently at the Bavarian State Brewery in the German town of Freising, located about 31 kilometers north of Munich. Zolo is not alone in his enjoyment for alcohol-free beer. The drink has been gaining popularity in recent years as interest in the alcoholic version decreases. Christian monks established Weihenstephan as a brewery in 1040. The operation began to produce non-alcoholic wheat beer and lager in the 1990s. Now those non-alcoholic drinks account for 10% of its total beer production. The same is true, generally, across Germany's beer industry. The people are unfortunately, I have to say that as a brewer, unfortunately drinking less beer, Zolo said recently. He spoke the day before the start of Oktoberfest, a 16-day celebration held yearly in Munich. Zolo said that if there is a way to offer a choice that has the crisp and fresh taste from a typical Weihenstephan beer, but just as a non-alcoholic version, we want to do that. Celebrants can choose that version at all but two of the 18 large tents at the event. The alcohol-free beer will cost the same as an alcoholic beer. Oktoberfest celebrant Michael Kesselitz of Munich seemed to approve of the drink choices. For people who don't like to drink alcohol and want to enjoy the Oktoberfest as well, I think it's a good option, he said. The 24-year-old continued, Sometimes people feel like they have more fun with alcohol, which is not a good thing, because you can also have fun without alcohol. If you want to come and drink alcohol-free beer, nobody will judge you. Oktoberfest began in the early 1800s. This year marked the first time an alcohol-free beer garden opened in Munich. Die Null, which means the zero in German, served non-alcoholic beer and other alcohol-free drinks near the city's main train station this summer. Walter Koenig is managing director of the Society of Hop Research. He said researchers have had to create special hops for alcohol-free beer. If brewers use the usual hops for alcohol-free beer, the special smell gets lost when the alcohol is reduced during the brewing process. But alcohol-free beer buyers do not care about that, Koenig said recently as he prepared for Oktoberfest. He explained, They only want to know that what they are tasting is as good as traditional beers with alcohol. I'm John Russell.
Scientists say they have found the largest jets of energy ever observed shooting out of a black hole in a distant galaxy. The jets extend 23 million light years from end to end. That is about 140 times the width of our Milky Way galaxy. The galaxy responsible is estimated to be 7.5 billion light-years from Earth. The scientists observed the structures using the low-frequency array, or LOFAR, radio telescope network centered in the Netherlands. Violent, highly energetic events around a black hole in the galaxy are the cause of the jets. A black hole is often the remains of a supermassive star that collapses. It is so massive that even light cannot escape its powerful gravity. Researchers have named the energy jets Porphyrion, after a giant in ancient Greek mythology. Porphyrion is 30% longer than any other known energy jet. Martine Away of Caltech is an astrophysicist and lead writer of the study published in Nature. Away said, "Jet systems like Porphyrion appear to be among the most energetic spectacles that have occurred in the universe since the Big Bang." The Big Bang is the event that scientists say marked the beginning of the universe. Astrophysicist Martin Hardcastle of the University of Hertfordshire in England was also a writer of the study. He explained how scientists believe the jets formed. "The general understanding is that jets are formed when magnetized material falls onto a rotating black hole," he said. He said the jets need to be sustained by a continued infall of matter into the black hole, something on the order of one solar mass, the mass of the sun, a year of material. However, although they are huge, the jets cannot be seen in visible light. Scientists used radio telescopes to find them. "They start small and grow over time," the scientists say. "We've known for a while that black holes can generate these jets. But what is interesting is that to generate a large structure like this, the jets must stay on for a long time, about a billion years," Hardcastle said. The Porphyrion jets reach far beyond their home galaxy. Their total output of energy is equal to trillions of stars like the sun. Away said, "The amount of energy is similar to when two clusters of galaxies crash into one another, each containing thousands of galaxies." Hardcastle said the discovery could increase knowledge of magnetic fields in the universe. He said, "The fact that it extends so far from its parent black hole means that it may be carrying energy, particles, and magnetic fields into the voids in the cosmic web. Such jets also could heat up gas in interstellar space, suppressing the formation of new stars, or could damage planets that could hold life, the researchers said. Scientists say our Milky Way galaxy has a black hole at its center, but it does not have a jet, and it is not active. However, the researchers noted that the most important finding of the study might be that black holes can create some of the largest structures in the universe. This means that individual black holes can have a sphere of influence that extends way beyond the galaxy in which they reside, Oi added. I'm Mario Ritter, Jr.
California recently enacted three legislative measures that ban the use of artificial intelligence, AI tools, to create false images and videos during election campaigns. The laws, which are among the strongest in the U.S., aim to reduce the use of AI to produce fake materials that could mislead voters during elections. California Governor Gavin Newsom signed the bills into law last week. One of the main goals of the California measures is to fight the use of so-called deepfakes. A deepfake is a piece of video or audio created to make it appear that people in it are saying or doing things that they never said. Deepfakes have already been used in political campaigns around the world. One of the laws requires large online publishers to either remove or identify content that has been digitally created or changed in an effort to mislead voters during specific election periods. Another requires any election advertisements that have been created or changed using AI methods to include a message informing the public that the material has been changed. The third bill bans the publishing of certain kinds of misleading information about campaign activities within 120 days of an election. All the California measures permit state law enforcement officials to take different forms of action against violators of the laws. In a statement issued after he signed the bills, Newsom said the measures were aimed at safeguarding the integrity of elections. He added, "It's critical that we ensure AI is not deployed to undermine the public's trust through disinformation, especially in today's fraught political climate." State lawmakers in several other U.S. states have passed similar measures in recent years to prevent deepfakes and misinformation during election campaigns. But critics argue that the laws are difficult to enforce and face numerous legal actions aimed at overturning them. The Associated Press, AP, reports two of the new California measures immediately faced legal action seeking to block the legislation. One of the lawsuits argues that one of the measures censors expressions of free speech and permits anyone to take legal action against material they do not agree with.
That lawsuit was brought by an individual who created parody videos that received public attention online. This included changed audio of Vice President and Democratic presidential nominee Kamala Harris. At least one of the creator's videos was shared by Elon Musk, who owns the social media service X. The governor's office told the AP the law does not ban satire and parody content. Instead, it requires material changed through AI methods to be clearly identified in videos, audio, or images. A spokesman for Newsom, Izzy Garden, said in a statement, "It's unclear why this conservative activist is suing California." Garden added that California's measure is nearly the same as laws passed in other states. But critics, such as free speech activists and Musk, have called the new laws unconstitutional. They have argued they violate the U.S. Constitution's First Amendment, which protects speech and other personal freedoms. Elena Beller is with Public Citizen, a nonprofit group that seeks to protect individual rights. She told the AP she does not know how effective such laws will be in stopping election deepfakes. Beller noted her group closely follows U.S. measures related to deepfakes, and none of them have yet been tested in court. Some technology experts warn that the law's effectiveness could be limited by the slow process of court actions. Misleading content, including deepfakes, might not be removed before harm has been done, the experts say. Even if it only takes a court a few days to act against such material, candidates and the election process may have already been hurt, Beller said. I'm Bryan Lynn.
Now, Bryan Lynn joins me to talk more about his technology report. Thanks for being here, Bryan.
Of course, Ashley. Thank you for having me.
This week, your technology report centered on new laws enacted in California that aim to prevent the spread of misinformation and deep fake videos during elections. Let's discuss some vocabulary words in the report.
Okay, sure. I think it might be helpful to talk about a couple of words that are related, but do have slightly different meanings. I am speaking about parody and satire. Both of these were used to describe content designed to be funny or entertain, and both of these are based on actual published material. For example, a parody could be created in an attempt to copy an actual performance of a famous person, but in a funny way. Satire is very similar, but centers on using jokes and humor to criticize people or ideas. Satire is also sometimes used to draw attention to a particular issue with the goal of achieving change.
And what other forms of these words can be used?
Yes, the term parody can also be used as a verb to say you parodied someone or something, for example. Satire cannot be used as a verb, but can be an adjective to describe something satirical.
Interesting. Well, thanks so much for that information, Bryan, and thanks for being here.
Sure, Ashley. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Anna Mateo.
And my name is Jill Robbins. You're listening to the Lesson of the Day on the Learning English Podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our series, Let's Learn English. This series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
We talked about lessons 21 and 22 in our recent podcasts. Today, we'll take a closer look at lesson 22. Anna is planning her new children's show with her producer, Amelia.
Washington, D.C. has four seasons: winter, spring, summer, and autumn, or fall. My favorite season is summer because of summer vacation. Hey, that will be a great subject for my new work assignment, the children's show. I can teach what families in the U.S. do during summer vacation. Today, I am planning the show with Amelia. This is the first time we are working together. I hope we can work well together. Hi, Amelia.
Hi, Anna. So, what are we going to talk about on the first show?
I want to talk about summer vacation.
That will be fun. Are you going on vacation this summer?
No, this summer I am too busy.
That's too bad.
It's okay. I can go on vacation next summer. This show will be a lot of fun, too.
We hear Amelia and Anna using going to in this lesson to talk about something they will do in the future. I think our listeners already know this verb form. But there are other phrases with going that may not be as familiar to everyone. Did you notice the way they used going on to talk about travel? Amelia asked,
Are you going on vacation this summer?
That is another way of asking, will you take a vacation this summer?
Yes, that looks like a phrasal verb. Anna uses it too when she says,
It's okay, I can go on vacation next summer.
That is like saying, I can take a vacation next summer.
And next, she uses another expression with vacation, take you on.
Hi there, and welcome to the show. Today, we are going to take you on a summer vacation.
As I understand that, she is saying we will go with her as she takes an imaginary summer vacation. In other situations, we use the phrase take you on to invite someone to go with us on a journey.
That sounds like a very nice invitation to go on a vacation with Anna. Just be careful. You don't want to say, I'd like to take you for a ride, because that is an idiom that means to mislead someone or lie to them.
Anna uses going in another way in the lesson. She talks about going to an amusement park. That is a place with many fun activities like roller coasters and games. There, we talk about going on a ride.
Another popular summer vacation is going to an amusement park. At an amusement park, you go on rides and eat lots of fun food.
So to summarize, we can go on vacation and go on a ride. And we can take someone on a vacation or take them on a ride. This reminds me of the old Steppenwolf song, Magic Carpet Ride. Do you remember that one, Andrew?
Of course. Why don't you come with me, little girl, on a magic carpet ride?
Our listeners may remember the story about Aladdin and the magic lamp. A genie takes him on a ride on a flying carpet.
In the song, the magic carpet is the girl's imagination. Jill, all this talk about summer vacation makes me a little sad because summer has ended here and we are moving into fall.
But Andrew, there are so many fun things you can do in the fall or autumn. There are harvest festivals, leaf peeping.
hold on a second there. Jill, I'm not sure our listeners know what leaf peeping means.
Then I'll refer them to a story our friend Ana Mateo did a few years ago. She said,
leaf peeping is when people travel to see the beautiful colors of fall foliage. Foliage is another name for leaves, and fall is another word for autumn.
Peep is to take a quick look at something. Like you might peep inside a box to see what's inside.
In the eastern United States, people like to travel to the mountains and places like the states of New Hampshire and Vermont to enjoy the beautiful colors of the leaves on the trees in the fall or autumn. Jill, have you ever noticed we only have one word for each of the other seasons, but we have two words for the season between summer and winter?
That's usually what happened when English speakers had contact with French speakers. Words that were originally in Latin came to the English language through French. It's why we have two words for a kind of meat, lamb and mutton. But let's get back to the fall. I really like the fall because it means the stores all have pumpkin spice flavored foods again.
Aha. So it's all about the food then. For our listeners, pumpkin spice is a flavoring that includes cinnamon, ginger, nutmeg, allspice, and cloves. These days in the U.S., stores begin to fill their shelves with pumpkin spice flavored food in August. It's kind of crazy. Anyway, if we're bringing food into the conversation, we've got to talk about pumpkin pie. What's your favorite pie, Jill?
That's easy. Pecan pie. At our Thanksgiving dinner, we must have both pumpkin pie and pecan pie to make everybody happy.
That's a topic for next month. Now, let's see if we can summarize with a little chant or series of sentences.
Oh boy, can I start?
Sure, go right ahead.
Ooh, that's another expression with go we can talk about. Listeners, try repeating after us to practice these expressions from the lesson. Here we go. I want to go on vacation. I want to go on a magic carpet ride.
You can go on vacation. You can go on a magic carpet ride.
Will you take me on a vacation? Will you take me on a magic carpet ride?
I'll take you on a vacation. I'll take you on a magic carpet ride.
I want to see the fall colors. I want to peep at the autumn leaves. And drink pumpkin spice tea.
You can see the fall colors. You can peep at the autumn leaves. You can have your pumpkin spice tea. But it's plain old coffee for me.
Now we have an assignment for you. We'd like to know your answer to our questions. What is your favorite season? And what do you like to do during that season? You can send your answer in an email to us at learningenglish@voanews.com. Or if you're watching this podcast on YouTube, put your answer in the comments. We'll read some of your answers on an upcoming podcast.
That's all for the lesson of the day today. You can learn more on our website, learningenglish.voanews.com. You can also find us on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram. And thanks for listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English Podcast. I'm Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins. Now I'm off to enjoy my pumpkin spice oat milk.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.